The customers of all these big services all told us the same thing, which is for the end user, so it's the designers and digital marketers, we spend hours each week scouring these massive catalogs. It's the same content everywhere. It all looks kind of stocky and staged. So we end up spending all these hours looking for something that feels a little bit unique and authentic. Mm-hmm. And then we went and spoke with their managers and the owners of these companies, and they said, I'm spending all this money paying my people, who are expensive people, to waste their time searching through these big catalogs. And we showed them our catalog, which at the time, remember, was like a physical product business. But we said, you know, ignore that fact that we're a canvas business for the moment and just let's look at the imagery, and their eyes lit up. Mm-hmm. That was when we thought, you know, that we had something that we might have backed into an opportunity that was much bigger than what we had realized before. Mm-hmm. Because the stock imagery business is a massive business.
Right.
And it's pretty fragmented. Even Shutterstock, as an example, which is a $2 billion publicly traded company, only owns about 5% of the market.
Right. So you guys talked to more customers, and then this time, well, you didn't say, okay, everybody said they wanted it. You didn't just build it out like crazy. You made a kind of basic version. Let's say it's called an MVP version. And sure. Then you got more validation, and then you went and raised more money. So it wasn't like you just went all out.
Exactly. Right.
Okay, so okay, let's fast forward. Now you've raised $8 million. You guys are go, go, go. Walk us to the next level that you get to.
It took us about 6 months to build all the infrastructure to actually go from serving, you know, those 10 or 20 customers that we had on this kind of really bad early version of the service to actually building something that could be used at some kind of scale. And we launched it publicly in February of 2015, so about 2.5 years ago. We went out, attempted to do a Series B in Q1 of 2016, which ended up being the worst quarter for venture financing in the last 5 year period.
Why was that?
You tell me. The Chinese stock market fell apart. There was a big challenge in IPO valuations here in the US, so nobody was getting liquidity on the top end. And all of a sudden, if you look at the graph, I remember the Wall Street Journal published in February a graph of like the venture deals done in Q4 and then the venture deals done in Q1. Mm. So we end up going out fundraising in basically the worst time possible. Find out nobody will fund the company, get a bunch of interest but no checks, sit down with the board and basically make a decision that we're gonna get the company profitable on our own cash, which looks highly probable at the time because our sales engine is generating so much cash at the time. So this is March of 2016. And we continue to scale that team, as I said, to the sales team from 15 to 20 in January to 35 by June, and make a decision in March that we're going to focus on profitability. And in April, the wheels fall off the entire thing. So all of a sudden, our bookings per rep go from 30 to 35 to 10. The burn of the company, so the amount of cash the company is using each month, goes from about 200 to 600.
Whoa.
In about a 2 week period.
Yeah, so what happened in that period? I mean, why did the bookings drop? Let's start with that first.
Eventually, what we realized were a couple of things. One is we had under-diversified in marketing. So because we had such a big push on driving scale, and because we were trying to do it without burning a ton of cash, we ended up having to hone in on only one or two channels that were really working, rather than continuing to nurture channels that were less profitable but showing promise. The other thing that we did, we had a lot of challenges on the sales leadership side. We had brought in a pretty seasoned VP of sales that ended up not working out. And then we, again, because of our big push and scaling fast, we promoted up one of our better AEs to running the team, who was a great and human, talented salesperson, but just not equipped at the time to handle the kind of scale that we were working on. So I would say we underinvested in systems, underinvested in marketing diversification, and then underinvested in sales leadership. Pretty massive errors if you're trying to go from 20 to 60 or 70 salespeople over the course of a year. Mm-hmm. So we hit a point in June where we had a bit of a crisis because we now had this big sales team, and the sales team was getting back on track, but not as quickly as we needed. So we were really eviscerating cash. We knew that we were going to have trouble bringing more cash into the company, and ended up making a pretty tough call in July to dramatically reduce the size of the sales team. And so we took the sales team from 35 to 5, and we had that team focus only on larger deals. And then we decided we had a little bit of early signal on self-service, so having companies come in and just purchase photos without talking to a salesperson. And we're going to begin experimenting with building, with increasing, in essence, the percent of customers that were being handled in a self-service manner. August 1, we put that team, that remaining 5 salespeople, entirely on larger contracts, which we had had some significant success with. And we launched the first version of our self-service engine. Mm. And in our first 2 weeks in market with self-service, that kind of shoddy V1 brings in more revenue than our entire 35-person sales team had at their peak. So we sit down middle of August and are looking at the data. And on the one hand, it's great news because all of a sudden we have this massive signal on a way to reach customers at a much bigger scale. On the other hand, we still have this sales team. And what we learned our first 4 to 6 weeks of doing enterprise sales was the deals are there. We're bringing in big customers like Apple and Microsoft, but the deals are much less predictable and take way longer. So that lesson of like, if you ever have to do layoffs, you want to do one and cut deeper than you need to. We thought we had done that. We get to the end of August and we're looking at the data, and it just is very clear that the self-service engine is massive. The enterprise, while there's a business there, is gonna be long, painful, and expensive. Mm-hmm. And we also, the third thing we did is we had at the time a 5-person services team, because when we brought in bigger customers, we would spend more time with them. We'd actually put a human on them. And we went really deep on the data, and what we realized was that when we looked at a customer who had an account manager assigned to them and spending time with them, and we looked at customers that were just acting in an entirely self-service manner, there was no variance in either NPS or customer retention. Mm.
NPS is Net Promoter Score.
Right, so there was no difference in how happy the customers were with their experience, nor with how long they stuck with the product. So we go through this extremely painful decision to again reduce the size of the company and to let go of another 8 people and 8 incredible people who had been with us for quite some time, leaving us with, actually I guess it was 10 people, and leaving us with only 10 left. So. Mm. In the course of 6 weeks, we had gone from a 55-person company to a 10-person company.
How'd you feel?
Awful.
What was going through your head at the time?
Just feeling pretty shitty. Feeling a lot of guilt, a lot of self-doubt. We had spent months convincing all of these ambitious, smart, quality people to come and join us on this mission to bring authenticity to creative projects, to create opportunity for these photographers all over the world. And they had trusted their careers to us and their livelihood. A lot of them had moved from other parts of the country. Mm. And we also had always had a very close team. We've always had a very open culture and really we started a company mostly because we wanted to work with our friends and people that we cared about. So these people were all, they were all our friends, and they were all really close with one another. So it was, for sure, those 2 days were the hardest of my career. Mm. And I think, there some of this is natural in startups, where you learn along the way what's going to work, what channels work, what products work. But we certainly made lots of mistakes.
A couple more questions as we work towards wrapping up. I mean, starting from the beginning, over and over, you're getting beaten up back and forth. And at a certain point, there has to be a point where it's just like, should I just throw in the towel? Did you ever face that kind of decision, or was that going through your head at any point?
Oh, many times, many times. I love that Ben Horowitz quote of the Wifio moment, so the we're fucked, it's over. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I feel like we've had more than our fair share, but we're still here. The one thing that we did that I think has really kept us going and actually moved us, leveled us up to a point where as humans, we're really thriving in the experience. And we just sat down as a team and we said, okay, we've been through all this shit. And we just lost 45 of our friends that we loved working with. It's up to the 10 of us to make this thing work and to grow it. If the 10 of us leave, like if any of the 10 of us leave, we're screwed. And so we sat down together as a team and we actually asked the question just really openly of what would it take for us to make this place a place that we're all excited to spend the next 5 years? Like, let's rip up everything that we think we know about how we should work, how a company should run, what it means to be venture-backed. And let's just start from ground zero and say, how do we want to work, the 10 of us, so that we can make this thing thrive together? And we changed a lot. We'd always been pretty transparent, but we became an entirely transparent organization. So everything, with the exception of salaries and the cap table, are totally public inside the company. I think those probably also will be in the coming months. We started involving everyone in kind of the learnings, transparency in all experiments, the quarterly, we started doing a quarterly offsite with the entire team where we review all of the learnings, all of the financials, any information shared from the board, so that all of that is public for the entire company. And I think it's the reason that everyone's here. Mm-hmm. We've had no attrition since we went through those layoffs. That entire team is here. And that to me is the most amazing thing. I mean, the revenue growth is great. We'll be profitable this quarter for our first time ever, which feels amazing. But the thing that really to me is the most surprising and meaningful of the last year is that that team has stuck together, become incredibly close. They're now this group of people that have been through what I think for all of us is the most meaningful experience of our professional lives.
Hey, so I hope you enjoyed that video. So all you gotta do now, let us know what you think in the comments if you'd like to see more of these. And don't forget to hit subscribe and hit the thumbs up, and we'll see you later.